Okay, we'll get started. So, welcome back after a scary Halloween party. I don't know how many of you celebrated Halloween. We did. So, the goal for today's class is to continue our discussion on dynamic watermarking algorithm, which is an active attack detection scheme. Actually, when I went to North Carolina State University last week, I was talking about dynamic watermarking. In fact, I was talking about exactly what we are going to study today. So it was, it's going to be a repetition of what I presented on Friday at NCSU. So our setup is as follows. Can someone tell me what was the notation? Yt equals to Cxt plus?
Vt plus Nt.
Vt plus Nt, okay. Okay, good. And Vt is the attacker's action. And this is the noise, observation noise. And the watermarking algorithm was ut equals to k x hat t plus et. Et was the watermark. X hat t was the estimate of the state. I'm just going to recap some of the notation from the previous class. And then rt was C X hat T minus YT. And when VT was equal to 0, then we define R bar T equals to sigma R 1 over 2 RT. Okay, this was the watermark. ET was Gaussian mean zero, variance sigma E. So this was the setting. And the hypothesis test was that this residual, this is supposed to be Gaussian with mean zero and covariance identity matrix. So when VT is equal to 0, when the system is not under attack, then R bar T is supposed to be a zero mean Gaussian random variable, Gaussian random vector with covariance equal to identity matrix. One thing to note here is that R bar T is not an IID Gaussian sequence because there is some dependence due to the estimator. There is some dependence with respect to the past. So it's not an IID process. Now let's put yourself into the shoes of statisticians and tell me, I want to detect whether there is an attack going on or there is no attack, right? So if VT equals to 0, there is no attack on the system. If VT equals to some non-zero value, non-zero vector, then there is an attack going on into the system. Now the question is, how would you detect if R bar T is a Gaussian with mean zero and covariance identity or not, right? Because that's what you want to check for detecting whether there is an attack going on or not. So what kind of algorithm would you come up with to check that condition, whether RBAR-T satisfies this distribution or doesn't satisfy this distribution. Any thoughts? I again want to remind you, RBAR-T is not IID Gaussian, so you can't really use some of the existing results we have talked about. Any thoughts? Let me start with a simple detector. So these are some of the, you know, I don't want to say bad detection algorithms. They are detection algorithms. They are not as strong as some of the other detection algorithms, but they are very simple. So let me just write it, simple detection. I think simple is a better word. Simple detection algorithms. Okay, these are not the main, not very strong, not very sophisticated algorithms, but the entire process is actually very simple. So the first one is chi-square detector. And here you check RBAR-T transpose, RBAR-T is less than equal to tau or greater than tau. This is no attack. This is attack. If you just take the norm of RBAR-T, if it is greater than a threshold, then there is an attack. If it is less than a threshold, then there is no attack. Okay? Very simple algorithm. Would it be easy to implement this algorithm on an embedded system? Yes, right? Very straightforward. You have to do a lot of work here for computing x hat t and all that stuff, but most of the embedded systems nowadays already have algorithms for computing x hat t. So if you're driving a vehicle and you want to know the velocity of the vehicle, there is already inbuilt filtering algorithms that tells you what the estimate of the velocity of the vehicle is. So even though there is some amount of work to be done in computing x hat t, getting to RBAR-T and running this detection algorithm is actually very straightforward. It's not going to take too much effort. So this is known as chi-square detector. Now let's talk about the second detection algorithm, which is Q-sum detector. Remember that Q-sum is a class of algorithms where you take cumulative sum of certain sequence. So it's not the same Q-sum algorithm that we have talked about, but it's within that same class of algorithms where you take cumulative sum of successive iterates or successive outputs. So in the Q-sum detector, you define a function A of R bar 1 to R bar T, which is given by, did I use A anywhere? No, I have not used A anywhere, so okay. So let me write it as A underscore Q sum. A underscore Q sum, R bar 1, R bar T minus 1. Plus gamma is some positive some positive number. Okay. So we would ideally like gamma to be greater than, okay, so let's think about it. So I have the old Q-sum score, I add the norm of R bar T, and then I subtract a factor gamma. Gamma is something that I need to pick. I'm free to pick whatever gamma I please, but it has to be a positive number. It's called a forgetting factor. So you're forgetting that much amount from the cumulative sum score. And then you have to pick again a threshold, and if it is above the threshold, there is an attack. If it is below the threshold, there is no attack. Now my question to you is, what's the minimum value of gamma you need? So let's think about this. Let's pick gamma equals to zero. Okay, so what happens when gamma is equal to zero? Every point of time, I'm adding a positive number to the Q-sum score. So this maximum doesn't really matter because I'm always positive. So I'm always increasing the Q-sum score, so I'm definitely going to exceed the Q-sum score beyond a threshold, whatever threshold I pick. So I'm always going to detect an attack, whereas there may not be an attack. And that's the situation when gamma is equal to zero. So what's the minimum value of gamma we want so that we don't come up with too many false alarms? What do you think? So remember, R bar T is a mean zero and identity covariance. And let's say I have not mentioned what the dimension is, but let's say the dimension of R bar T is in Rm, which is the same as the dimension of the observation space, Rm. So what do you want your gamma to be greater than? Well, we always have to subtract. So if R bar T were normal in the sense that if there is no attack going on, this is going to be a positive number. And what is the norm of RT? So the expected value of the norm of R, okay, let me write it here. So my R bar T is Gaussian with identity, then expected value of R bar T transpose R bar T. What is this going to be equal to? Can someone tell me what this is equal to? Well, it's equal to the trace of identity matrix, which is equal to the dimension of R bar T. This comes from some properties of expectation. So it's equal to the dimension of RT, R bar T. So we want here gamma to be greater than this expectation for the Q sum to not be an increasing sequence. At some point of time, it has to decrease, and sometimes it will increase. So it will do a random walk, And then if there is an attack, it's going to exceed the threshold with high probability. And if there is no attack, it's not going to, I mean, it will not have too many false alarms. So we want gamma to be strictly greater than dimension of r bar t, actually, which comes from here. Now, of course, you have to carefully pick gamma. So for whatever application you are designing this Q-sum detector, you have to carefully pick gamma, and you have to carefully pick tau so as to balance the mean time between false alarm and mean delay. Is this a difficult algorithm to implement on embedded systems? Not really. It's also fairly straightforward. You might need a few more bits of memory in comparison to this, because you now have to store this QSUM score and you have to store this gamma. So slightly more memory is needed, but it's fine. Memory is cheap in embedded microcontrollers. Any questions on these two detection algorithms? I'm going to erase them and I'm going to start with a third one. Sorry?
QSUM score. So the average QSUM score is R1T plus till RTT. And why are we taking till T minus 1?
So this is the QSUM score at time T. This is the QSUM score at time T minus 1 plus the update term. Okay, so it's a, maybe I should put a comma T here, so as to differentiate that they are QSUM score at two different times. Any other question?
Tau is, of course, positive number, right?
Yes, tau, of course, yeah, is a positive number.
So this whole term has to be less than tau in order to not to give any false alarm.
Yes. Yes. I mean, you will always have false alarm. You cannot help it. But you just want the false alarms to be very sparse.
Yeah.
And you want the detection to be as fast as possible. Right? And as we have seen that in your first assignment, you have seen that you just have to make trade-offs. There is no way to have mean delay equals to zero and mean time between false alarm to be infinity. So you have to live with some trade-off. Any other question? Okay. Let's talk about third detector, which is a hybrid detector of these two detectors. It's called MUMA detector. Moving exponentially weighted. No, exponentially weighted moving average. What does this? MEWMA, MUMA detector. So I know that this one stands for exponentially weighted moving average. I don't remember what this M stands for. But anyways, this is MUMA detector, where you define GT equals to beta R bar T plus 1 minus beta GT minus 1. And you define 2 minus beta over beta GT transpose GT less than equals to tau greater than tau. beta is between 0 and 1. And g minus 1 equals to 0. Okay. So in this particular detector, you weigh the previous value of GT with the updated term R bar T that you have received at this time. Beta is sort of a forgetting factor here. You use that to get the value of GT. So GT of course kind of keeps increasing, but then it stabilizes at some point, assuming that there is no attack. So you have to pick a somewhat higher value of threshold tau here in order to be able to not have too many false alarms. But this is the detection scheme for MUMA detector. Again, not very difficult to implement and very easy to execute these sort of detectors in embedded microcontrollers. But here is the problem with all these three different detectors we talked about. There is always an adversarial strategy by picking VT according to some special distribution that you can evade these three detectors. You can completely evade them. The system will never be able to detect those attacks on the system because VT, the attacker, is a bit more intelligent and it has come up with some specific attack policies that can evade those detectors, which is why those detectors are not very strong. So you've used a simple detector, easy to execute, but the problem is that the adversary can come up with a better attack strategy which can evade these detectors. So that's the sort of drawback of these detectors. So we need to come up with a better detector, and unfortunately, that's also a very complicated detector. So if there are no questions on this, I want to move on to a more complicated detector. In this case, when beta is close to 0, it's almost like a QSOM detector. When beta is close to 1, then it's like a chi-square detector. It behaves like a chi-square detector. Oh, actually, for beta equals to 1, it is exactly a chi-square detector. So this is sort of a hybrid between the two detectors, the QSOM detector and the chi-square detector. Sits somewhere in the middle. Okay. Now I want to come up with a more complicated detection algorithm. So I'm going to erase this side. Any questions? No questions? Okay. I'm going to define a few things. So the first thing is I'm going to define K prime to be minimum value of K such that C A plus BK, no. This is capital K. This is small k. This is small k. This is small k. B not equal to 0. let me put this on this side. So this capital K is the gain of the controller. This C is the observation matrix here. And this B is the control matrix here. Okay, so that's how we define K prime. K prime is the number of steps needed to, number of time steps needed to measure the effect of action in the observation. Okay, that's the physical meaning of K prime. So yeah, I'll repeat that once I see everyone has written it down.
The small k's are, this is a small k.
This is a small k, this is a small k. This is a small k, and this is capital K. This capital K is right here. Let me write it as this. So then, this capital K, and it's the same as the controller gain here. Okay. So let's try and understand what this K prime is. Okay, so there is an air, suppose there is an air conditioning system at the roof of this building, and that air conditioning system started pumping cold air at this moment. Okay, it's going to take perhaps a minute for that cold air to travel through the entire ductwork into this room. Okay, so this K prime is equal to 1 minute. So this is the number of time steps needed that, so that if you make a change to the action here, how long is it going to take for you to see it in the observation? Does that make sense? So I started pumping cold air at the roof of this building, and this is a 5-storied building. So I started pumping air right now, but I'm going to see that cold air coming into the room after a minute, because it's going to take that much time for the air to travel through the ductwork into this room. So if I'm looking at the temperature of this room, which is the observation, I'm going to see it, if I make a change right now to my action, I'm going to see it after a minute. Okay, and that's why, and that exactly is equal to K prime. How much time does it take for you to observe the change in the action in your observations? The observation is coming from this thermostat right here. Okay, so that's K prime. That's the physical meaning of K prime. Now I'm going to define sigma psi to be equals to sigma r 0 sigma e. I'm going to define psi t, sigma psi inverse square root RT E T minus K prime minus 1. Okay. Now I'm going to define a function of, so x, I have already used small x, d, have I used d? I have not used d yet. Okay, so I'll use d. So d is a positive definite matrix. Then I'm going to define a function l I j d as I plus 1 minus j over 2 log of determinant of D plus half trace of D plus log gamma I, sorry, this is a somewhat horrible expression, but that's what you expect from a complicated algorithm. Sorry? What is this? This is the dynamic, this is a continuation of dynamic watermarking. We can call it algorithm number 4, which is a more sophisticated algorithm. It's not a simple one, it's a sophisticated algorithm which can also be used to detect the attacks. So one thing you will notice, oh, I haven't yet mentioned what the attack detection strategy is. So here is the attack detection strategy. M plus Q. Oh, I have to define DN. I have to define DT equals to summation n minus l plus 1 to n psi I transpose. So this is a positive definite matrix. Well, it's a sum of rank 1 matrices, but it has to be positive definite, otherwise this term is going to blow up. And then your L M plus Q DT is less than equal to tau, no attack, greater than tau, attack. So this is dimension of ut plus dimension of yt. Okay, that's it. Okay, so what is this algorithm trying to do? So if you remember the previous algorithms 1, 2, 3, we only took into account R of T. We didn't really take into account the fact that my action contains the signature, the watermark E of T. So in this algorithm, so those were the three algorithms. It didn't take into account any information about E of T. Now, we want to take into account the correlation between E of T and R of T. But remember, E of T doesn't affect R of T immediately. If I turn on the air conditioning system on the roof, it's not going to change the temperature right now. It's going to take some time for the air to flow. So you want to check the correlation between the observation that you are making now versus the watermark that you had implemented 1 minute ago. Okay, so that's the t minus k prime minus 1 time step. So these two random variables are correlated now. Okay, et and rt, they are uncorrelated. But et minus k prime minus 1 and rt, they are correlated because of the fact that in k prime time step, any action you took shows up in the observation. Okay, so now you have taken into account this correlation. Now you are coming up with a very complicated function. So let's boil down what this function is doing. It has log of determinant of d. The d is defined right here. So d is psi I transpose, the summation over a window of length L, small l. That's the window. You can pick a very large window or you can pick a small window. That's up to you to decide. But you pick a window length L sufficiently large. You construct dt by taking psi I transpose, and then take the summation, where psi I is defined here. Okay, now you take that dt, you plug it in here, you have log of determinant of dt, you have trace of dt, and then you have what is known as a multivariate gamma function. Again, some complicated function, but it can be computed. So you have a multivariate gamma function with some log term and some multiplication factor. So you have a bit complicated function. You have to compute determinant, you have to compute log, you have to compute trace, you have to compute a multivariate gamma function and log of that function. So this is going to take quite a bit of time for you to execute on a microcontroller. So your microcontroller be really big for you to be able to execute this algorithm. So to give the car example, you don't want to implement this algorithm on an embedded microcontroller in car. You want to have a computer inside the vehicle which is running this algorithm all the time to detect the attack. Now, of course, if you have autonomous vehicles, it's not just a computer. There are like multiple GPUs running and crunching all the numbers. So, you know, you will have those kind of sophisticated, powerful machines in vehicles, in autonomous vehicles, to do this detection. So anyways, you come up with a very complicated algorithm, complicated function of this dt, the test statistic. And then if it is less than equal to tau, there is no attack. If it is greater than tau, then there is attack on the system. Now, in this case, if an adversary is persistent, it will get detected, okay? For sure. So this function will increase and you will be able to detect the adversary in the system without fail. So that's the more sophisticated version of dynamic watermarking algorithm. As you can see, it's not that easy to implement, but it is going to detect a persistent adversary without fail, okay? But of course, it can give you false alarms as well, but that's fine, we can live with that. The other important thing I want you to note is this is RT, not R bar of T, okay? So just something to keep in mind. Okay, any questions so far? Yes.
Q is the dimension of Y in that expression, yeah?
Yes.
Q is the dimension of Y,
M is the dimension of U.
Because Y, it doesn't have like...
I'll make it Q. Yeah.
Okay. Because VT also in the same equation.
So yes.
Should they be...
It also has dimension Q.
So should it be like the same dimension, both of them? Like 2Q or 2M?
No, this is dimension of U, sorry. It looks like V, but it is actually U. This U,
okay.
Dimension of the action.
And when you choose a window, you said
yes, L
to calculate D.
Right.
This is like you're choosing a window of data.
That's right.
Previous data.
Correct. Previous data.
To calculate D.
Yes.
And then, like D is going to be just a simple matrix or a series of matrices?
No, it's going to be a simple positive definite matrix.
Okay.
It's going to look like this. So psi I transpose, it's a rank one matrix. You are summing up a lot of rank one matrices, but you definitely want it to be positive definite. So your window length has to be sufficiently long so that this is a positive definite matrix, so that this log of determinant of D doesn't blow up, okay? So log of zero, if D is positive semi-definite, then determinant of D will be zero, and then log of zero would be minus infinity. So not very useful.
And this one is dt, so you are calculating d every...
You look at the past data, you compute dt, you plug it into this particular expression, and then you check whether it's below tau or above tau. Okay? This will give you a real number. This is going to give you a real number. This is an R. Okay. Any questions so far on this one?
So also before attack detection algorithm, this one will be better efficiency, like in terms of detecting algorithm?
Right. So this one has the most desirable property, which is if you have a persistent attacker, you will be able to detect it. But in the other three algorithms, the attacker could be intelligent and could come up with an attack strategy that is undetectable using those detection algorithms. So I could come up, so in the other three, so in 1, 2, 3 algorithm, I could come up with a special class of VT which will be undetectable. The detection algorithm will never be able to detect those VTs. In this case, no matter what VT you pick, the detection algorithm will be able to figure it out. It's only a matter of time. Now, of course, in autonomous vehicles, you want to detect it within like 3 or 4 seconds, which would be 30 or 40 time steps. So it's very complicated. I'm not going to say that it's easy. In the case of a nuclear power plant, you want to do it, you want to be able to detect any attack within a matter of a few microseconds. So even more difficult, okay? In a building management system, you can take 15 minutes to figure out if there is an attack happening or not. I mean, it's not going to blow up, okay? But these are the three different examples I wanted to tell you where this scheme would be useful, but then the detection has to happen within like microseconds versus seconds versus minutes. Okay.
I and j are not like incremental values over here.
No, they are fixed. So this L is fixed, the window length, and this m plus q is fixed because it's dimension of u and dimension of y. Okay, now let me remind you that ut was k of x hat t plus et. Okay, this is my ut. Now can someone tell me what is the problem with this class of algorithms? So one problem I'll tell you is it requires a very specific, well, I mean, nowadays you have more complicated systems for which this dynamic watermarking algorithm has been developed, but it requires linear time invariant, or in some cases, your XT has to be a XT has to be a vector in a Euclidean space. And in all these situations, your ET has to be a Gaussian vector. What is the property of Gaussian vector? It can take both positive and negative values. It can take infinity value as well, or minus infinity value as well, with very small probability. So these are some of the drawbacks of this particular dynamic watermarking algorithm. Can someone tell me some other drawbacks of this dynamic watermarking algorithm? I gave you two of them. One is this is defined for LTI system, which can be extended. But the second drawback was you want the state to be a Euclidean space, you want action space to be a Euclidean space, and you want this ET to be a Gaussian vector, which means it can take positive and negative values. What other problems do you see with this algorithm? Yes. Right, but that you have to do in all the algorithms. Like, you have observation noise, you can't help it. There is no way to help that. So think about it this way. You have an autonomous vehicle that's going on a highway versus going around the university. So around the university, the car is traveling at 10 miles an hour. On the highway, the car is traveling at 70 miles an hour. Correct. So not just changing over time, but it's actually a function of the state, right? So at 70 miles an hour, you can't really put a Gaussian random vector, because that will be like you are changing the steering every millisecond, which will be a very bad experience for the person sitting inside the vehicle. So the real drawback that I view in this particular scheme, it's actually a beautiful scheme for, say, building management systems and so on, because all of those could be put within this particular framework. But there are a few situations where this algorithm would be useless. The first situation is when your noise has to depend on the state. So when you are driving at 70 miles an hour, you cannot have a very high variance of ET. You want your ET to be very small in magnitude. On the other hand, if you are driving at 10 miles an hour, it doesn't really matter. You can steer it as you want. It's not going to affect that much. So that's one thing. The ET has to be dependent on the state of the system. So this one doesn't allow that flexibility. And the second drawback that I see with this algorithm is it's not general enough. So what if I have the state which is on or off kind of state, okay? Or a state which is like a queue length kind of situation, which is your assignment one. So in those situations, it's not Euclidean space. Your observation is not in Euclidean space. It's the set of natural numbers, or it's a set of active or sleep state, or it could be on or off state. So there are situations where you have what is known as categorical states, or you have a natural number. Your state is a set of natural numbers. So this dynamic watermarking algorithm cannot be applied to those particular problems, because it exploits this particular state transition and the observation equation in order to come up with the detection scheme. So motivated by these considerations, we developed another dynamic watermarking algorithm for Markov decision processes over finite state space. So in our setting, your XT is a finite set of states. The state space is finite, the action space is finite, but you have perfect observation. So if you have a sensor which is sleeping, you can observe that it is sleeping perfectly. There is no noise. There is no uncertainty about what the state of the system is. Or if there is a queue length, you can observe the queue length under no attack, of course. So those are the situations which we are trying to model in our work. And we came up with the algorithm, and that's what I'm going to talk about now, which is, you know, our own version of dynamic watermarking algorithm for those situations. This algorithm was developed in collaboration with Ford Motor Company for exactly the same reason that I talked about. You know, you can't have a Gaussian random variable of the same variance both at 10 miles per hour speed and 70 miles per hour speed. Now, you guys are all expert on MDPs now, because you have done an assignment with discrete state space. So now we can talk about that detection algorithm. So here is the situation. My xt plus 1 is a function of xt ut wt. Your x is finite state space. Your u is finite action space. And more importantly, you have u of s, which is u of x, which is a set of actions, feasible actions, at state x. Okay. So I have a finite state MDP. And here is the cool thing. At every state x, there is a set of feasible actions that can be taken. Okay, so I have defined that here. Now, let's think about it. When I'm driving at 10 miles an hour, when my state is 10 miles an hour, there are a set of feasible steering angles that are okay for the driver to take. But when you are driving at 70 miles an hour, the set of feasible actions is actually much smaller, okay? So I'm allowing my actions or set of actions to depend on the state in my setting, in the setting here. Okay, now any policy gamma, so this is policy gamma, which maps your x to u, must satisfy gamma x in ux. So I'm only going to restrict myself to policies which respects these feasible action constraint at every point of time. Okay? And if you look at the, I'm sure you will, in the future, you will take some course on Markov decision processes, but it's not very difficult to come up with policies like this that respects the constraints on the actions. Typically, they will be posed as a constrained optimization problem. And then you can solve the constrained optimization problem. We talked about it at the beginning of this class, not this class, but this course. And you can identify a feasible policy that satisfies all the constraints and is an optimal policy or near optimal policy for this kind of MDP. Okay. Now the question is, how do you run watermarking on problems of this type? What would be an equivalent of watermark for this particular case? So here is the issue. In the case of the watermark, you added a noise to the action itself, right? So ut was a Euclidean, it was a real number or a real vector, and you could add a Gaussian noise, and that was considered a watermark. Now in this case, where your action is just a finite set of numbers, how would you define a watermark? Okay? So I'll leave you with this question, and we will come back to this question in the next class. And I'm going to tell you how exactly can we add a watermark in this particular situation. So I'll see you guys on Wednesday.